when he comes back in the probably the 7-year tribulation period to announce Jesus, the Messiah, to the Jews. But we can be doing that now for the Gentiles and the Jews that are here now.
Because he danced. Because David danced. I reckon Jesus would have been just fine with that. I don't know how they keep these on, by the way.
You're supposed to have them around.
Burns me up. It's like laying your jacket off, okay?
So,
so So I just put my jacket to the side. But you know, something that's really happening here. If you look out right now, it's sunset. Right? You see the light's almost gone. And at on the Feast of Trumpets, seventh month, first day, which this is, at least as best we can tell, they're supposed, what the Jewish people would do, they would go out and they would send two people out to look around and see if they can see the new moon. You know, when the moon goes through its whole cycle, at the end of the month, it disappears, goes away. And that will be about 14 or 15 days after it's a full moon. We have a, so maybe that'd be good to help. So on the seventh day in the first month, they determine that by, well, what does the moon look like? Because, you know, the word month, of course, comes from moon. So there's a full moon, middle of the month on the Jewish calendar. This is when the Passover happens, first coming, crucifixion. It's also when the second coming will happen at the Feast of Tabernacles, full moon. But the Feast of Trumpets is a new moon. And right there, there's no moon. And that's what happens the first of the Jewish month. But they don't know that until the new moon starts to reappear. If we could see the sky right now tonight, we can't because of the clouds. That's what we'd see. We'd see a crescent, the horns of the moon. And when the Jewish people would, they would assign two people that were trained to go out and see the moon. And they would go out and look. And when both of them reported back to the Sanhedrin, the leaders, and they both said, "We see it," then they'd say, "Okay, it's now the Feast of Trumpets." And that would have been last night. Tonight, it's still about like this. The night before that, there was no moon. The astronomers today will say, "Well, that's a new moon." So because there's a lot of trouble, not even counting the clouds in the sky, right? If they go out tonight and there's clouds, they look and they look. No moon. So because of that, they called this festival the Feast of Trumpets, the time that no man knows the day nor the hour. And Jesus, when he said, "No man knows the day nor hour of my return," it's, I really believe he's talking about this festival. And we don't know the day. The Jews today still don't know the day. If you go home and you Google when is the Feast of Trumpets, it's also called Rosh Hashanah, the New Year. It'll say, well, it could have been the 14th of September. It could have been the 15th of September. It could have been the 16th of September. It could be the 17th. Because they don't know. Now, it is the Feast of Trumpets tonight. And at sunset, They did a peculiar thing, and they still do in the synagogues all over the world. They get a trumpet. Now this is a ram's horn trumpet called the shofar. It's a little baby one. I used to have one like that, and it got stolen. You all see a shofar at a pawn shop. It might be mine. But now, this is not the only kind of trumpet. If you look, there's also a silver trumpet mentioned. They use these in the temple. But what they would do, at the end of the day, at sunset, on the Feast of Trumpets, now all day long they blow the trumpets, 100 times. They do sets of 30. But finally, at sunset, which according to what I'm seeing here, sunset tonight was at 7:38. Now, if I look up there, I'm still saying, well, I ain't sure. Hard to determine the time of the sunset. But they would do one blast of the trumpet. It's called the last trump. That's what it's called. Tekiah Gadol. The last great trumpet. And that would be the last. That'd be the end of it. Now we know that Paul, we know what he says at the last trump. So, therefore, there's good reason to believe that the rapture is associated with this Feast of Trumpets. But that's just tonight is the Feast of Trumpets. I don't know whether to blow this little one, because I'm going to call this sunset. We'll do. This one's a lot louder. The other night I blew this, I was practicing on Mom, and she jumped out of her skin. And she can't even hear. You know, that's what's going to happen one day when Jesus comes and he blows the trumpet. We're going to jump out of our skin. For real.
That's right.
And the dead, it's going to raise the dead. Not just because it's loud, but it's going to be loud. It says, in fact, here's what it says. Do you remember? It says, he shall descend from heaven with a
shout.
And with
the voice of the archangel.
And you reckon that's going to be loud?
Yes.
And with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. So I'm going to blow the trumpet. If you've got a trumpet and you want to blow one of these trumpets, blow it. But shout! You know, and so what it was doing back there in Leviticus, God told Moses, he said, tell them to remember by the blowing of trumpets and the shouting. They didn't know, they still don't know what they're remembering. You know why? Because like with all the other festivals, Jesus is the Lamb of God slain. What does the scripture say? From the founding of the world. So the Passover lamb in Egypt was a shadow, although it happened first. And you know who cast the shadow? Jesus. And he cast a shadow on this one too. Terry usually lights the candles. We have seven of these, representing the seven festivals. The fifth one, I already got it. I asked her earlier, I said, well, I don't have a lighter. She said, you don't need one. So, first one, on the left, Passover. You know who the Passover lamb is? Second one, Feast of Unleavened Bread. He's buried. Unleavened bread don't rise. But guess what? Dead people don't either. Until the Feast of First Fruits. Guess what happened? The bread that was laying down flat arose. And then 50 days later, Pentecost. And this happened at the first month, 14th day. That's a full moon, number one there. That's a Passover. And then on the fifth one, which is where we are at now. Now you see, these were all exactly prophetic. Jesus died exactly when they sacrificed the lambs on the Passover. Check the scriptures in the Gospels. Passover, Passover, Passover. Especially the Gospel of John breaks it down clear. He's laying down in the grave. He raised again on the third day. Feast of First Fruits. Those happened exactly as the Jewish people were celebrating their festivals. Exactly. Not close. Exactly. 50 days later, you know, after 40 days after this one, he went out and from the Mount of Olives, and Ernie over here had a picture of when he went to Israel a few years ago. And he's on a camel on the Mount of Olives. Over there on the Mount of Olives, they've got a place laid out there, a tourist place, and it's got a footprint in it, looks like a footprint, kind of like that thing over there at Bear Trap, like a bear's print. But it looks like a man's foot. And they say, this is where he took off, where he was last seen. That was the day 40 after this. Because it says after 40 days. And then he said, and go and wait in Jerusalem. Why? Because on day 50, he's going to pour out his spirit on all flesh. And that's what he did. Exactly. Remember Acts chapter 2? When the day of Pentecost had fully come. It didn't come a minute too soon. It didn't wait a minute later. He came and he poured out his spirit on all flesh exactly on that festival day. And here we are on the seventh month and the first day. And one of these days, he's liable to return at this time of the year. Now, you go out and look for the moon. It says you don't know the day nor the hour. So, Here, I'm going to blow a trumpet. Terry, you want to blow a trumpet? If you blow a big trumpet, I'll blow a little trumpet. They might want to hear what. You know, this morning early, I had to go over and meet some of our people that work over near Stanton. And there's a goat over there, a ram. It has horns, each horn's that long. Terry, you've seen that, haven't you? Biggest goat, and it got in front of me, and I had to follow it all the way up the road. Blowing my horn. Not this horn. I'm trying to get him out of the road. And they had all these little goats with him. About 10 of them. They had button heads, and they were jumping and playing. He's just trying to get out of the road. So, because this day is not just a trumpet day, but a shout. So if you're here, and what we're doing, we're going to remind God of what he said. Paul wrote it, that Jesus is going to come back. He says the Lord is going to descend. So if you're here and you're ready, you shout. Stand up and shout as we blow these horns. Well, I can barely blow this one. It's a baby horn. All right, let's go. So, that's to remind. You know, Jesus. The scriptures say in Leviticus chapter 23, verse 24, do this to remind yourselves as a memorial. They don't say for what. And all the others, he tells them. The Passover, he says, you remember when the lamb's blood redeemed you. And he tells them to remember when you unleavened bread. You remember when you got out of Egypt, you didn't have time to let your bread raise. You remember that. He said, you remember first fruits when the first of your crops come up. He said, you remember Pentecost, because he said what happened at Pentecost was Sinai, Moses on Sinai. He said, you remember that every year. He gets the trumpets. To this day, they don't know what they're remembering. Oh, they'll say, well, that's the day when Noah's Ark landed. Or it's the day of the creation of the world. This is the day when Adam was created. But they're making it all up. Because God didn't tell them why. You know why? Because in the New Testament, Paul says, I'm going to reveal to you a mystery. And he reveals it. And that's when he talks about the trumpet. So tonight, now we kind of reenacted it, right? The angels, the archangel, Jesus, they heard the shout. I reckon them angels don't know when they're going to come back either. And they're probably looking around at the Father, because it says only the Father knows. And the rabbis would say, you know, Moses, God didn't tell Moses when the new moon starts. Only the Father knows. They were saying that 1,000 years before Jesus came along. So some of these things that Jesus was saying doesn't mean we have no clue about when things will happen. It means that it's going to happen probably at this time of the month. Probably. Seventh month, first day. We just don't know when it is. You could go out and argue with the Jews for a month about when it is. You go look it up. They don't know when it is. Some will say this day, some say that day. But that's not the important thing. You know what's important? Are you ready? Are you ready? And that's the question I want to ask you tonight over and over again is, are you ready? We have it on good authority that Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy One, who was born of a virgin, who lived a virtuous life and died a vicious death, and who was resurrected a victorious conqueror, that he's coming again.
Amen.
We're concerned with this question this night in particular because it might be the time of the year when he comes. Leviticus 23:24. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall you have a Sabbath, a memorial of blowing of trumpets, a holy convocation. God originally called the months by their number. He didn't call them. I hear a trumpet. Nobody ain't gone. Really, that sounded like a shofar. Didn't it sound like a shofar to you?
Yes, it did.
I mean, we could all go out in our cars and blow our horns, but that didn't sound like a Buick.
It didn't sound like a Rolls Royce neither.
No. There's somebody around here that either heard us blowing a trumpet.
Yes, sir.
Or, oh, it was you. She tricked us. We thought the rapture doesn't happen. We all been left behind. That's a good trick. I'd look and see which one of y'all was leaving. Then I'm thinking, what am I doing here? And that's funny enough, but are you ready? Can you imagine if the trumpet sounded and you stayed?
Come on. That's right. Come on.
Imagine looking over. You know, this is not a graveyard.
No.
But old Daniel Boone was walking through here a couple hundred, 150, 200 years ago. Any of those that were born again, raised, men of God, if they were shot by an Indian right here with an arrow, and their bones are here, and it wouldn't surprise me. He's just down the road. He went through Walford Street and all that. What would you think? You hear a horn blow and you see Daniel Boone coming up out of the ground. Well, I'm thinking, the dead in Christ shall rise first.
Yes, come on.
Yeah. I'm next. So, in seriousness, are you ready? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Are you ready?
Come on.
It's going to happen.
Yes.
It's bound to happen. You know, if it don't happen, Jesus is the worst fraud, the worst liar that has ever lived. Because more people believe that and the things that he says, then they believe anything else. And the scripture says it. The Lord himself shall descend. And Jesus said, I will come for you. If I left you, if I leave you, I will come back and receive you to myself. So Jesus said it. It's recorded in the scriptures. If it don't happen, Jesus is a fraud. It's going to happen. Everything else he said is going to happen. Happen?
Yeah.
Come on.
All of them. It's going to happen. I don't know when. The disciple says, when, Lord? It's also in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep or be dead, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Are you ready? Now, there's a lot of people, and I talked to a couple today. They said, that's nonsense. He ain't going to come. You all say that all the time. We've been hearing it since we little boys. Jesus is going to come. You better be ready. And he ain't never come yet. Well, I thought of this verse. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lust, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation.
Come on, brother.
That's a prophecy too. If Jesus is going to come the year after that, it's wrong. People are not standing around saying that so much. Now after 2,000 years, people saying it. He must not be going to come. Maybe he meant something else. Maybe that's a parable. I mean, even Christians, some of them doubt that he's going to come. But the question is, are you ready? And by the way, if the scriptures say, by the mouth or in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. And you know there when he ascended, you remember we were talking on the 40 days after he rose from the dead? Do you remember who was standing there? All the disciples were there. But there was two men in glistening clothes. Angels. And everybody's standing there gawking. Wow, he can fly! And they say, men in Judea, why do you stand here looking up in the sky? This same Jesus who you see leave will return in like manner. He was on the Mount of Olives, Ernie. Scriptures say. So, you know, he's going to, that's going to be after the rapture, but he's going to return. Not just the angel, but we had the word of two angels, right? We had the word of Jesus. We had the word of God telling us he's going to return. Listen, Jesus is not the kind of guy to tell us lies, to be a fraud. He's not. If you know him and his spirit is in you, you know he don't lie. In fact, he said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. That means he's coming. If he don't come back, he's the loftiest liar, a deluded deceiver. But he's coming back.
Amen.
So, you know, first, Christians here, you know, I don't know who's a believer and I don't know who's not. You don't either. But as a believer, if you're here and you are a believer, are you ready? Because, you know, you need to be ready too.
That's right.
You remember that parable of the 10 virgins? They were 10 virgins. And 5 of them was left. This is a warning to the believer. Are you ready? If the trumpet sounds now and the Lord comes and the angels shout, will you go up? It don't say, it don't say, did you used to believe? Are you a believer?
Right.
Not past tense.
Come on.
A lot of past tense believers.
Come on,
bro. Say, I used to believe. Yeah. I talked to the wife of a man today, and she's like, you know what? 6 weeks ago, he was a preacher. Mm. The wife says, he's given up. Tossed in the towel. He says, ain't going to have nothing to do with the ministry. Are you a believer?
I am.
You got to be a believer now.
Yes.
Not just used to be. I know a lot of people that used to be believers. That are no longer believers. And if the trumpet sounds, I don't think they'll go up. And if they come to judgment, I don't think they'll go to heaven either. It's not a past tense salvation. It's a present salvation. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling.
Yes.
If it's past tense, you don't need to do that.
No.
If it's a future tense, a present tense, you need to work it out.
Right.
It says work out your salvation
right.
with fear and trembling.
Yes.
Are you ready? Not all believers are ready. We know that because many shall appear to Jesus in that day. And what's he going to say? Well, the scriptures say, he's going to say to many people,
depart from me.
And they're going to say, but Lord, I did all kinds of things. I tithed. I cast out devils. I taught Sunday school. I went to church. I blew trumpets. He's going to say, well, okay, you did. But you never knew me.
Amen.
And I never knew you. It's a relationship.
Amen.
So, believers, tonight, before we close this service, make sure you're ready.
Amen.
It's not something to take for granted. It's not a game. It's not a past tense salvation. Make sure you're ready, because it could happen at any time. Amen. Look, Jesus said there'll be wars and rumors of wars before he comes. Have y'all heard the rumor that Vladimir Putin may nuke us? It's on the news. His counselors say he's thinking about it. That's a big rumor. In fact, it'd be hard to beat that rumor, especially if it came to pass. The coronavirus. How many of you think something worse is coming? How many of you think it'll cripple the country if it comes? You know, you want to see the mark of the beast coming? Probably headed our way in the form of some kind of pestilence, some kind of virus. You can't go in nowhere unless you've got maybe the mark. I almost couldn't go into Walmart without a mask on. I couldn't buy or sell without a mask. Not legally. But heck, they shut our churches down, right? We had church out in the parking lot. And some churches still were, they were penalized some way. And that's just a precursor. Coronavirus, bad enough. But it can be a lot worse. But believers, make sure you're ready. I don't know if you're ready. You don't know if I'm ready. Make sure you're ready. There's a way to make sure. All right, now let's turn to the unbelievers. I'm not going to ask you if you're ready. You know why? Because you ain't. You are not ready. You're not ready for what's going to happen. If the trumpet sounds, you will be left behind. You will face perilous times. And Jesus describes them basically this way. You ain't never seen or heard nothing like it.
That's right.
It's the worst time that has ever been since the beginning. There's been some bad stuff happen. How many people died this past week? And I don't know, is it earthquakes now or is it tsunamis? What country, Ernie?
Libya.
Libya?
Yeah.
How many are dead there now?
I think they said maybe 15,000.
Wow. 15,000 and counting?
Yeah.
Last week there was, 1,000 or 2,000?
Morocco was, I think, around 5,000.
So, and this stuff's happening right now. That ain't nothing. What's going to happen during this time that we call the tribulation? If you have trouble believing now in this Jesus, it's going to be a lot worse then. And most are not going to make it. If you can't believe now, if you're here in a service about Jesus, and you can't believe now, you may be thinking, oh, I'd never take that mark of the beast, I'll be fine. Listen, if you're here now and you won't accept him, you've not accepted him, you're going to have a hard time. You know, I'll just share this. Yesterday, as I was walking through the dollar store in Frenchburg, and I thought, the dollar store's everywhere, right? I think they're putting them within like 4 or 5 miles, so if gasoline gets so expensive we have to ride horses, we can make it to the dollar store. Any of us. Does anybody live more than 5 miles from a dollar store?
No. Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
How many miles are you from a dollar store?
10.
10? They're probably going to put one out there any day now. I think they are.
Yeah.
Or are they at Zachariah?
Zachariah's going to get a third. Yeah, Zachariah.
It's close.
It's coming.
Yeah.
They need a dollar general, there'll be a family dollar. But I was walking through the Frenchburg dollar store, checking out, buying stuff to go in the cabins where I work. And just suddenly from nowhere, I had a strangest thought. This was last night, about this time. I was walking through there, and it just, you ever have just thoughts from nowhere? And I had thought, you know these air raid sirens that all the towns have now, if there's a tornado or, I guess, a nuclear bomb, anything like that, they would put these sirens off. And in my mind, I was thinking, I was thinking, it was as though I was walking through there and I heard sirens go off. It wasn't really, but I had this thought. And I could see myself walking up there saying to the cashier, what's going on? And in my mind, in my thoughts, maybe I just daydreamed, I'm thinking that I walk up there and they say, haven't you heard? We've been nuked. There's nuclear bombs being dropped on cities in the United States. And these sirens are going off everywhere. Not that that means anything. But it happened to me yesterday. And then this morning, I woke up. I was warm and comfortable, you know. Most of us wake up warm and comfortable in the bed. And I was thinking, you know what my thoughts immediately went to? I was thinking about, in the tribulation, it says, that the kings of the earth, the nobles, the commanders, the rich, the mighty, and every slave and free man hid in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of the one seated on the throne, from the wrath of the Lamb. That's not a warm, comfortable place. And I was thinking of that. There's going to be people crawling up in caves, sleeping on the ground, on rocks. Bad time. Unbeliever, if the trumpet sounds now, your chances of going to heaven will be a lot less. And I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why you can't believe. If you're here and you can't, and you don't believe. It's because, Paul says, if the gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not. So, if you're here and you're lost, it's because you're blinded to Jesus Christ. Because there's no reason to reject Him. There's no reason not to believe Him. There's none, none. There's not one person that would tell you, I made a mistake by trusting in Jesus. What does that mean? That means that you're being deceived. You're being blinded. And the Scriptures say that. And I was talking to a young man today and trying to get him to come here. And the conversation got off on guardian angels. Because I believe in guardian angels. Scriptures mention them. But you know what? It also mentions personally assigned demonic adversaries. You know, when it says in the Scriptures that the devil goes about seeking whom he'll devour. That don't mean Satan. There's a lot of devils. If our eyes were opened, they probably devils all around. Some of y'all might have a devil in you. Right? Not everybody that has a demon in them knows they have a demon in them. I've talked to somebody one time. I've known them for a while. I'm not going to get too revealing. They might figure out who I'm talking about. I got born again. I went to them. And I said, Jesus changed me. I'm not the same as I was last week. Because he hit me with a Holy Ghost stick. I'm different. I don't see things the way I used to. I don't do the things I used to. And that's not something that I did. It's something he did.
Yeah, come on.
I don't know how you ever saw that movie, The Exorcist, where people speaking in multiple voices. They did that. And ordered me out of off the property. Off the property. Just because I said that. And they were speaking in multiple voices. You know, and this person I was talking to today, they said, we've seen devils. I said, well, it's probably your personal devil. He's after you. He's keeping you blinded. That big trumpet trying to fall. I said, that's probably your personally assigned devil. That's Lucifer, Satan is just one. He can't attack us all. But we all under attack. Because just as surely as there's guardian angels, there's enemy devils.
Yes, sir.
They're trying to keep you blinded. They're trying to drag you into hell. So if you're thinking, well, maybe I'll wait a little longer and get saved. That's your devil telling you that. Whispering that in your ear. Wait just a little longer. If you're thinking, oh, people make fun of me, that's your devil telling you that. You've got a personal devil after you. And believer, you've got a personal, your personal devil is still there. Why do you think it says resist the devil and he'll flee?
That's right.
You resist your devil when he comes with a temptation to you. He knows you. He knows me.
Amen.
He knows my weaknesses. He knows how to tempt me.
Absolutely.
Jesus had the devil after him. Now that might have been Satan. I think it was. He tempted him three times. And then I reckon he fled. That old devil. He didn't flee after the first time. Or at least not for long. He didn't flee after the second time. Not for long. But now after that third time, you don't see him hanging around Jesus a whole lot more. At least we don't have a record of it. So whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, you've got a devil after you. You've got a devil. And he knows your name. He knows your habits. He knows where you go and what you do. And he wants into your life so that he can bring death, theft, and destruction into your life. That's what he wants. Your devil. And that's his only, as far as I can tell, that might be his only goal in his miserable life, is to destroy you. And he don't, no. If you resist him, the scriptures say he's going to let up for a time. I don't think it means he's going to leave forever. Because I resist him, and doggone old devil come back again. He might come back tomorrow. He don't go too far sometimes. There's only one safety in it. If you're an unbeliever, you don't have none. You don't have no safety. That devil's whispering in your ear all the time, giving you all kinds of reasons. If he has to, he'll give you money.
That's right.
To keep you lost. He can do that. He can cause you to find $100 bill waiting out there. Or he can cause you to... The God of this world offered Jesus a lot of stuff. These devils, they can offer us a lot of stuff. And it might be worth their while to do it. Not every pile of gold is a blessing. So, believer or unbeliever, devil's after us. All of us. A devil. Not Satan. I doubt that any of us are important enough to rank Satan. He's probably after a president somewhere. You know? I mean, that's right. He may already have him. But, right? I mean, Satan himself can influence a leader of a country that changes everything in the country. He's not going to pick on me, probably. Not the devil himself. Satan, Lucifer, not that one. But listen, as far as I can tell, it is said that there are as many angels as there are stars in the sky.
Yep.
Yes.
All right. How many are there? There are more stars than there are people. A third of them. That's what it says, right? A third of them fell from heaven. They got plenty to pile on us. You know why some people got a legion of them? Because they have plenty of them. They have plenty of devils. Another thing. Now, I've saw devils manifest. The person who stood up and spoke in that, get off the road. It wasn't their voice. was not their voice. It was multiple voices because there's multiple people talking. When Jesus said, "What's your name?"
Legion. Adalek said, "We're Legion."
You probably heard all kinds of stuff coming out of there. We are Legion. If you hear somebody talking in multiple voices, which a normal human can't do anyway, right? You can't talk in quadraphonic stereo. That person probably got a devil. If you see them exhibiting supernatural strength, that person probably got a devil. I mean, like a little girl knock you across a room because you talk about Jesus. Right? Good sign. They don't like to hear the name of Jesus. So, but the most effective strategy the devils have, your devil, my devil, in this nation, is to make you think they ain't there. That's their most effective. If they was to manifest right here in front of us, they're going to take you all to hell. A lot of people get saved. Then probably the altar would be flooded. Big devil walk up the streets and battle down there. All right, I'm going to take you all to hell. And him 12 foot tall, the claws that long, but it says he runs about like a lion. I reckon that caused people to get saved. That ain't going to help the cause of the devils. It's better for them, as long as they can deceive you by whispering little stuff in your ear, it's better for them to stay hidden. So in this country, they stay hidden for the most part. Occasionally they manifest, but not often. I reckon the big devil, Satan, probably whoop their behinds if they go around manifesting all the time. Because that's not gonna further their kingdom of darkness. If everybody said, "Well, these devils run around, you better go find Jesus. You better go to church. You better get on your knees and pray. Devil's gonna get you." That's why you don't see them manifest. Go to another country where they believe in all this stuff already. And they'll tell you, "Well, the devils are real. They think we're crazy. We think they're crazy for saying they see devils. Them witch doctors in Africa and all that. They think we're crazy. We're not believing them." But they say, "They put a curse on me, my leg fell off." I mean, they real. I have a friend who was a missionary in Ghana, Africa. And he said that he had one of the natives that came to their mission. And then one day he said, this native comes to him and he says, "The witch doctor done heard about me coming to church and he put a curse on me and said my arm's going to fall off." And my friend, who was a missionary in training, spent 4 or 5 years over there, he said, "Look, that is foolishness." He said, "But I see other people's arms fall off, legs fall off, and die. Happens all the time over here." My friend said, "Listen, I'm telling you, it's foolishness. Don't give credibility to it." So about a week later, he comes there, his arm swelled up. He says, "See?" My friend said, "Well, you must have got bit by something." He said, "No, the witch doctor bit me." A couple days later, his arm's turning all different colors. My friend said, "You got gangrene." And so he takes him to the doctor in the middle of the jungle. It was. He says, a little wooden hut. He said, "I took him in there and took him upstairs and said, take care of this man." And he said, "I went outside to relieve myself." And he said, "I'm standing out there," and he said, "I hear something going over my head, lands in the bushes. And I run over, it's his arm." They amputated his arm. Not long after that, my friend got out of there. He don't like to talk about it. His denomination don't believe in such things. He said, "They're real. I assure you." He said, "You go over there. You mess around with witch doctors and stuff over there." Now, he said, Jesus is the answer. But them people that don't know Jesus, they know the devil's real. We civilized people are the ones who doubt it. You know why people go over there and they'll have big masses of people come and there'll be people healed, be resurrections from the dead? It's because them people have seen what the devil does. He kills people, makes zombies out of them, makes arms fall off. they believe that when they hear of this Jesus, they're ready for it. And they believe because they've seen it. And if they've seen the bad stuff, they believe the good stuff can happen too. Sometimes we can be overeducated and too enlightened. Don't underestimate your personally assigned evil spirit. I promise you, he is out to get you. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober-minded and alert. Your adversary. That don't mean the whole world. That means your adversary. The devil. And that don't mean Satan. You have an adversary that's a devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. There's your devil. And my devil too. Waiting. With his mouth open. Waiting for you to see in and open the door so he can come in and bring destruction. If believers are warned to be alert of your adversary, how much more should unbelievers be aware of what's going on? But they have no protection. Just this general, you know, we do have the Holy Spirit here in this age of grace, this age of the church, this Pentecost age. The Holy Spirit's here, and he helps ward it off. So you have some general protection. You don't have much. You get deep in sin, you're probably going to really be attacked hardcore by a devil. Drugs will bring you down. They'll open the doorway and the devil will come in. I was praying for 2 weeks. I wasn't praying that y'all be here. I'm glad you're here. Probably most of y'all born again. I prayed that the drug addicts and the people that need Jesus would be here. Because I don't know how to reach them. I talk to them. I pray. And it's, you know, one of them had promised that they would come to church tonight. Got sick this morning. Another one. We don't know where he's at. He got a jail just here. Month or two ago. And every day this week, I've been texting him, trying to get up with him, trying to call him. This morning, finally, he says, I'm sorry I haven't been answered. I've been sick. And I said, well, won't you come tonight? We'll come get you. He said, well, I'm going to text my friends the way we will. Heard nothing else from him. That's who I wish was here.
Amen.
Wish y'all was here to pray for him. But, you know, that's the ones that my heart goes out to. Because they have no protection.
Amen.
The devils have got them. We would be surprised how many people probably have devils in them. I think we would be shocked. I've heard people say, well, you know, y'all see devils everywhere. Behind every rock. Sometimes there's two devils behind that rock.
Amen. Come on, man.
Our problem is we don't see them.
Exactly.
It's not that we see them too often. Question of the night. Are you ready? Are you ready? Whether you're a believer, whether you're an unbeliever, don't matter what you are you ready to meet the one who's coming? And I'm going to close out with that. Are you ready? And there's no better question, no better time to ask it either, than the night that might memorialize the time he's going to come. He's telling us to remember something that ain't happened yet. You know, the Passover is the same way. He's telling them to remember the lamb, the blood of the lamb. And the real lamb hadn't died yet. He's telling them to remember him before he died. That was the Passover. That's what all 7 of these do. Remember something that ain't happened yet. Our minds kind of get warped up in that. He could come anytime. We could sit and talk, well, the temple's not going to be built in Jerusalem. You know what? We don't know everything.
Amen.
We don't know everything. We say, well, that covenant's not been signed over the 7-year covenant. We don't know if it has or not. All I know, they're writing their name on the paper right now. Mm-hmm. For all I know, they won't tell us for a year.
Amen.
You think our government tells us everything going on? I don't know if they would tell us that the Antichrist has signed the covenant, the 7-year tribulation covenant. I doubt they'd put it on CNN. They'd probably hold it back. See, now people will panic. They think that's Antichrist. They'll quit doing this. They'll start going to church, whatever. They ain't going to tell us nothing. The Holy Spirit can tell us. We can't trust the government, our government, any government. They're going to tell us the truth. It's went downhill fast, I reckon.
Amen.
I know they wouldn't probably tell us the truth about JFK when he got shot.
Amen.
That was the start of it, maybe. Now I don't know if they ever tell us the truth. I'm sorry. I just don't know. They tell us right now the economy is great. I don't believe it. That's what they're saying. You heard today on TV, didn't you, Billy? How good things are? Listen, things ain't good. Money goes nowhere. Think $100 bill goes far? You don't cost $30 to eat out at a restaurant? $25 at McDonald's? It's going to cost $60 to fill your car with gas.
There you go. I was going to say that, but I didn't want to interrupt you.
It's true, though. Think of it. Bread ain't $3 or $4 a loaf. Yeah. Milk, $3 or $4 a gallon.
Exactly.
You can go on and on. You think rent ain't $1,200 a month? It is. Maybe not right here. But it's $700 or $800 a month. I guarantee you it's almost doubled in the last 4 years. Everything. The economy's not good, but they say it is. Well, it ain't. The government's not going to tell us. They're not going to tell us when the Antichrist comes. They're not going to tell us none of that stuff. Listen, they're not for us. Not poor Christians. Not for us. They'll keep it hidden. Anything that would bolster our cause, that would increase our faith, they'll keep that hidden. They'll keep it hidden. The big devil was to walk down the streets of Babel. I doubt if they'd report it that way. It would be a deluded conservative wearing an outfit, goes on a shooting rampage, something like that. Sometimes these things are devils. Anyway, are you ready? Now you were here. Everybody shouted. Some blow trumpets. And I'm including myself in it. We need to daily examine ourselves and make sure we're ready. We can't take it for granted. This is not a video game. This is real life. Eternity looms before us. Hell and the lake of fire looms.
Yes.
Heaven looms before us. Listen, we're not this body. We're going to die or we're going to be changed. That's what's going to happen to us. I know a lot of people don't pay taxes. Somebody pays, it says death and taxes. But you're going to, so far, everybody's died but Jesus and Elijah. And Enoch. Right? And I reckon they're coming back. All three of them. At the end of the age, I think some of them's coming back. Anyway, that's not what we're talking about. What we are talking about is being ready. So if you're not ready, and Terry come and somebody or somebody come play music. And this is a good place. Listen, I'm nothing special. I'm nothing special. I have to examine myself daily. I want to be ready because I know he's coming. Well, I know I'm going to die. He's going to come or I'm going to die. Either way, I want to be ready. A lot of people go out of this world not ready. People get ready for stuff all the time. They get ready for church. They get ready for work. Half the time you call somebody, what you do? Well, I'm getting ready for something. I'm getting ready to go to the dollar store. And they don't get ready for the thing that matters. And it means getting ready now. Being ready now. Don't put it off. You got to be ready. We don't got no promise of tomorrow. Listen, Jesus could come tonight. We could die tonight. But, and you know, the odds are not that great that neither one, you know, that neither one of them will happen. These people all the time dying. Jesus ain't come back yet, but he could. And so, well, something's going to happen. Something is going to happen. Are you ready?
Lord, prepare.